Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. My dearest brothers and sisters in Islam, welcome to episode number 29, Moments with the Qur'an. Today's moment comes from Surah Al-Ahzab, and in particular, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لَقَدْ كَانَ لَكُمْ فِي رَسُولِ اللَّهِ أُسْوَةٌ حَسَنَةٌ لِمَنْ كَانَ يَرْجُ اللَّهَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَالْيَوْمَ الْآخِرَ وَذَكَرَ اللَّهَ كَثِيرًا. SubhanAllah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in this particular ayah, he says, indeed, in the Messenger of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a perfect example. A perfect example for who? For the believers. For those who desire the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For those who revere Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For those who fear the judgment day. And they remember Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in abundance. For these people, meaning for the believers, and these are the qualities of the believers, that they revere Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they fear the day of judgment, they have good hope in the reward of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. For these people, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is indeed the best example. Now, brothers and sisters in Islam, in previous episodes we've highlighted that when we say La ilaha illallah, then we're basically declaring that there's no one worthy of worship besides one Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and everything about our existence on earth is for His sake alone. So if our life is for His sake alone, then no doubt we need to live on earth how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants us to live on earth, not how we want to live on earth. Because if you're a servant of Allah, then this means you're not a servant of your desire, or a servant of your culture, or a servant of modernity, and so on and so forth. You're a servant of Allah, which means now you need to comply, right? Based on how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala requires you to comply and requires you to live on earth. How do we know this? We know this from the second part of our testimony of faith. After La ilaha illallah, we say Muhammadur Rasulullah. Subhanallah. Right? So we say, Ya Allah, I declare you the only one worthy of worship. And Ya Allah, I will only worship you, I will only live, I will only breathe, I will only act based on, when I say breathe, I mean my actions. I will only speak and I will only act based on the mandates and guidance you have taught us through Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And that is why, as a rule of thumb in Islam, when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, his way abrogated the way of the previous messengers that were different to his way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala permitted something during their time, but now when Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam came, it was forbidden. His way is the binding way. It abrogates all previous ways, the ways and practices of other prophets. So here, subhanallah, we see Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through telling us a reality of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he, you know, that he is the best pattern, the best example for the believers. Here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us this, and in the testimony of faith, we declare our belief in what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is telling us in Surah Al-Ahzab, in the Quran, and we also declare that we are ready to only live our lives upon the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That before we do anything or before we say anything, we ask that, you know, what is the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam with regards to this? Did he teach us that saying this or doing this is beloved to Allah? If he did, I will do it. If he didn't, I will leave it. This is what Islam is, and submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, because Islam is istislam, submitting to the will of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the moment that you are in. And how do you know what Allah wants from you in that moment? By looking into the sunnah. So if you want to be a husband, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is an example for you in terms of how to be a husband upon the way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants you to be a husband upon. If you want to be a wife, you need to take guidance from the sunnah. You want to be an effective child, a child that pleases Allah, you have to take guidance from the sunnah. You want to be an employee, an employer, a community member, a grandson, a grandchild, a grandparent, a relative. Whatever your role is, right? Whichever roles Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given you, or roles that you have assumed, whatever the role is, you need to ask yourself, what is the teachings of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in terms of my speech and action within this role? I've assumed this role, and it's for the sake of Allah. I need to be in this role upon the mandates of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, because Allah taught him how I should be in this role. So now I need to look at what he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Now, the scholars have a discussion about the practices of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and they divide it into three categories. They have the first category is his practices which are worship. It's the worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then no doubt this is sunnah. And he's an example for us in this matter. And we should follow this way. It's a matter of the religion. And he did it to teach us to do it, and we must do it. But then he has other practices which are known as adat, norms. Meaning, it wasn't something specific to him or the Muslims. It was something that the non-Muslims did and the Muslims did. For example, the dress that they wore, or the head covering that they had, and so on and so forth. This was something that Abu Jahl did and the Muslims did, right? The kuffar did, the disbelievers did, and the Muslims did. It was circumstantial to the norms of the people, right? And so when it comes to this, the scholars say that these are norms. These are norms. We don't call these sunnah like in the first category, right? Whereby when we talk about the sunnah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in terms of his actions of worship, right? These are things that we must do, and we're rewarded for doing it. As for norms, these are norms, right? So the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam dressed, for example, if it was not something specific to the Muslims, and this was a norm of his society. However, from these norms, these actions that are from norms, we have things that did become worship. For example, from the norms of the disbelievers was that they would fold their lower garments, and this was a sign of seriousness, right? And they were praised for it. I mean, today, I don't know, maybe in the English language we have, you know, we're going to fold up our sleeves when we get ready for some hard work. We say, fold, you know, he's folding up his sleeves, he's getting ready to work hard. So back then it was a norm that they would fold up their lower garments, and this was a sign of seriousness and hard work and so on and so forth. But this became, this transferred from the category of things that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did as a norm of the norms of his people to the thing which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did as an act of worship. It was a practice of his, which was an act of worship. What would be an example here? This example that we're speaking about, folding up the lower garment, right? Because it was a norm, but then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, whatever is beneath the ankles will be in the fire. Subhanallah. So now this transferred from this category to the first category. We say, no, keeping your lower garment above your ankles is from worship. It's from the practice of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that are part and parcel of the religion, not part and parcel of the norms of his people. So the first category is that which he did, which is part and parcel of religion. The second category is that which he did sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which was part and parcel of the norms of his people. It wasn't specific to the Muslims. Then the third category is that which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created him upon. This is known as al-awsaf al-jibiliyya, human nature. You know how some people walk and so on and so forth. This is from human nature, right? So, for example, do we say that it's from the religion to try and walk the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked, or do we say that it was his nature to walk in this way, right? So, no doubt, no one can say walking this way is wrong. In the least, we can say that. But do we tell people that everyone now should try and walk this way? No, we don't say that, because we didn't even see the Sahaba radiallahu anhum ajma'in trying to imitate the natural human nature of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Rather, in fact, when we look into their statements of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we see them telling us with intent that which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam did, which was from the religion, from the first category, a norm that was attached to worship. But with regards to the actions that were attached to worship. But with regards to the second category, actions which were attached to norms, and the third category, actions which were part and parcel of human nature, we don't see them telling us this radiallahu anhum ajma'in with intent. Rather, they tell us it in passing. As the scholars say, yathkurunahu aradan. They mention it in passing, because we want to know everything about our Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam. But there is a benefit from it, and that benefit is, in the least, if someone walked in a way that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked in, and somebody else came and said that, you know what, don't walk like this, it's not right. We say, no, how can you say it's not right when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam walked like this? And if it wasn't right, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would have not created him upon this nature where he would walk sallallahu alaihi wasallam in this way. In any case, this is a discussion from today's moment from Suratul Ahzab. It has gone over our normal time of 5 to 6 minutes. However, it's an important lesson. Moving forward, brothers and sisters in Islam, let us try and analyze ourselves and ask ourselves, what is the guidance of Rasulullah sallallahu alaihi wasallam in all the roles that I have? Because he is the best example for me, as per Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala's revelation in Suratul Ahzab. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us truly upon the sunnah and far away from bid'ah and innovation. Ameen ya rabbal alameen. Until next time, salamullahi alaykum wa rahmatuhu wa barakatuhu.